Thank you, Bill, for the very nice introduction. And then welcome everybody for this first, for the second morning session. So I think my task for today is to introduce you to this idea of open BIM or global sharing or interoperability within the BIM world, and also give you a little bit of insight what's behind IFC and what it is, and maybe also how it should be used or maybe how it should not be used. So that would be some of the topics for today, but also give you a little bit perspective of what is coming next. And the next major theme essentially is IFC for infrastructure. And in general, I believe the next major theme is BIM for infrastructure. We are much too much focused on just buildings. And the world of, or let's say the built environment is much larger than the buildings. Let me just check. Okay. Yes, but first give you a little bit of background. So IFC, or as it stands for Industry Foundation Classes, it's a very old term going back to the mid-90s. It's essentially an open standard for exchanging BIM information, and it's developed by a large organization, Building Smart, or Building Smart International, which many of you might know, although I have heard that it's not so much, let's say, active here in Ireland. But in many other parts of the world, like where I'm coming from, in Germany, in France, but also in Scandinavia, in all the Asian countries like Korea, Japan, China, and so on, it's a very active body to organize or to help the transition of the industry towards more interoperability, more digitalization. So the previous name of Building Smart was IAI, or Industry Alliance for Interoperability. And we, at some point, we decided that's just too much syllables in that, and it became this new name, Building Smart. So this organization is a neutral organization, non-for-profit, and so on. So it's a very good host to develop an industry standard. And that's, as I said, happened since essentially mid of the 90s. So there's almost a 20-year history now. So it's not necessarily something new. What probably is not so much known that Building Smart is also developing other kind of standards. I mean, it's developing so-called MVDs, or model views, the parts of IFC for certain purposes or certain exchange needs. One of the famous, I would say, spring off of IFC is actually COBE. I hope you can agree with that. because it also came from this basic definitions from IFC, and then took its specific road to satisfy the exchange needs for the asset management industry. There are others of this, and I will go into that. There's a different standard called BCF, or Building a BIM Collaboration Format, which is about communication issues or communicating change requests. It's coming from the same organizations. And there are others like this Information Delivery Manual, which is about creating a common understanding on the exchange needs in a design project. So, and then, as we say, Building Smart is a non-for-profit organization working worldwide, but it's not a standardization organization per se. And we have others like ISO, which is the International Standardization Organization headquartered in Geneva, or we have being in Europe, or hopefully still in Europe. We have CEN, which is the European standardization organization in Brussels, and then, of course, we have national standards. Like in Germany, we have DIN or DIN. In UK, we have BSI. In Ireland, we have the Irish, you hopefully can spell it, organization. So I think Building Smart itself tries to do what we call pre-standardization. It means it's creating the consensus in industry, bringing the industry needs on board and developing a standard proposal, although later helping it to deploy, for example, like a certification process and so on. But Building Smart cannot really issue official standards, and that's why there's a strong collaboration with these organizations. There's so-called liaisons, it means it's a direct one-to-one relationship which exists between Building Smart and ISO and CEN. And that's why IFC, that as it was developed in Building Smart, is now an ISO standard. It's an international standard. It's ISO 16739. And as of 2 weeks now, it's also a European standard or a European norm. So it's an EN ISO. And as being a European norm, it's mandatory for all European member states to make it a national norm. So let's say it will be a DIN norm by end of this year, beginning of next year, and it will also be an Irish norm or standard by the end of the year. So it's not just a specification of organization, it's now also a norm which is issued throughout Europe. Which of course makes it quite easy for clients, in particular public clients, to demand deliveries against an official published specification standard. And that's something also what we see happening now. What is IFC as such? I mean, in its very fundamental as a delivery, you could look up at the website when you go to buildingsmart.org and you scroll down and you find IFC. It's a specification which represents the kind of its common view or a harmonized view of the construction industry about the definition of the elements, like a wall, a pipe, in future a piece of road or a deck in a bridge, with all its geometric representation, kind of geometry to express its shape, but also about all these attributes, the information pieces you have to provide, and also the relationships in between, like a window is part of an opening in a wall, so you can maybe later query from the opening to the window and vice versa. Or you have a pre-built spatial structure like that there are stories, and stories have or contain elements that then are related to a story, and a story relates to a building and so on. On a very high level, you can see it on this diagram, which is the basic, I would call it backbone structure, of the IFC schema itself. Everything is related to a project, which is construction project. It has a series of metadata like the units used, the geographic information system it's based on, its own coordinate system, and the classifications you are using, I don't know whether it's a uni class and so on. Well, that's kind of metadata on a project level. And then you can structure every BIM data according to the standard, either spatially, you can have, let's say, a building, stories, spaces, or maybe later in infrastructure, you probably will have alignments and sections along an alignment as a spatial structure. You have functional structures, for example, in the mechanical side, you can define what belongs to an electrical system versus structural systems versus a mechanical, a ducting system, for example. And then the main item which is expressed in this exchange standard is the component or element. That's any piece of physical existence, as I said, like a wall or pipe. It would be represented by geometry, and essentially could be multiple types of geometry. Could be a pipe could have a line representation, being, for example, the center line, or could have a 3D representation, being essentially this 3D tube you actually visualize. And it could have hold a series of attributes, material, any kind of, functional data, flow resistance values in a pipe and so on. And this red arrow means that components could have an element breakdown structure. For example, a facade could be a component, and underneath you would have then the lintels and the steps and the stubs, and so on. And those can, for example, have the fixing structure, the fixes in between. And since in construction we work a lot with repetitive components, I mean components being of the same type, there's a type structure which could be used to define components that are used multiple times. I don't know, for example, the same girder is used multiple times in construction as a single type that's then only referenced by giving it a placement or repeating placements. And by this you can share its geometry or can share its attributes. I think that's fundamentally a very basic structure on how IFC works, although in reality, of course, it's much broader and more complex. But giving this very broad structure, it's also clear that it covers many domains. Yeah, we've mentioned a few of them already, like architecture, structural, mechanical fire resistance services and so on. And the actual exchange, what really happens in an industry, is not that I provide everything what I have to everybody else, but I would like to give a focused information. Yeah, I would like to, for example, share the architectural model with somebody to do class detection to verify whether it fits with the mechanical system. And so I always say every of these exchanges has a purpose. And if I do not define the purpose, it's becoming quite often meaningless exchanges. And the answer for IFC on this is that we define something what is called a model view definition, or essentially a subset of this overall structure that is specific to the purpose of the exchange. And that's why it's quite difficult to say we are changing IFC, because what does it mean? We should be more specific, saying we are exchanging an architectural model for clash detection, for example, or we are passing the architectural model to someone to do energy analysis, or we are giving the contractor's model to someone to prepare it for facility management. Yeah, and that's the purpose of the exchange. And as said, we have the so-called model view definition for that. It's a subset of it that also focus implementation, because the schema is too big to be implemented in high quality by the various software companies. So it would focus this. And then, of course, this IFC exchange against this model view definition should also be used for this purpose and not for something else. So I think we have to look a little bit more about the purpose of the exchanges as it's done with IFC. And I think the analogy people had in mind, maybe in the past, it was DWG, and that was my drawing, and everybody gets my drawing and doesn't really care what's on the drawing. That doesn't count anymore, because our BIM models are much more information rich, and we have to express what we have to say what we actually want to exchange, and not saying, here's everything. And I think there was a lot of misunderstanding in the industry around this in the past. And we have to be much more specific on that. And we exchange actually a model view or a focused IFC exchange. One of these model views, which is probably most known, is this so-called coordination view, which is again meant to be the subset of the IFC information that can be used for coordinating building designs. And when I now look into such a coordination view file, which means an IFC file that's maybe generated by one of the industry softwares, what data could be found inside? And I just put in here a little, some examples of that. For example, on the right hand, this, on your side, right hand, yes, on this large window, you see all the different elements. And you can also say that the ontology or the semantic classes or all the element classes that are in that file. So you know, do I receive windows or walls, how many windows, and so on. This is the element structure. But you also see somewhere one of these functional structures. I think it's a German file. So Vorlauf, Rücklauf means it's the predecessor or postdecessor in an HVAC system. Like when I have a piece of pipe, what's on one side, what's the next element on one side, and what's the other element on the other side, which just gets connected. So all of this kind of information is in an IFC file, because you store all of this connectivity there. Or other ones, you can see the spatial structure, whether that's a story or a building, how many stories are there, and so on. So this is the kind of information you can actually receive. You can visualize it in a viewer. You can use it for collision checking, coordination, clash detection, and so on. But you can also use it for simple reporting, just to say how many windows are actually in that architectural design I was given to me as, let's say, an HVAC designer, just to get this. And one of the new developments in Building Smart is so-called MVD XML. That's really taking this idea of MVD to a next level, that you can actually query. It's a kind of query language that can be used then to answer these questions: how many windows? Or another question is, if I demand that every window should have a fire resistance value, is it actually present? Is it actually included for every window in that file? These kind of questions. Because IFC as such gives you a structure, doesn't demand you that every information is already filled in by the architect before. But with this, you can also query and validate the information that you receive. So coming a little bit to the essentials, and there's also maybe one idea where I said what you should use IFC for and what you should use it not for. As I said, I mean, BIM, IFC definitely does not replace BIM tool formats. I mean, if someone uses Revit, you will use an RTF file. If someone uses Archicad, you will use a PLA file, yeah, you will still have your own data, and that continues to be so. That's definitely not a replacement for that. It's also not a universal database as such. There might be implementations like BIM Server, which is one, like Open BIM Server and others, that implements it and provides you a service for that, but it's not the pure IFC data. So essentially, the purpose of IFC is to exchange BIM models between different disciplines for coordination, further assessments, reuse of information, and so on. It's really passing information along the workflow. And I try to symbolize it with this, that IFC is not one of our most famous German creatures, the Eierlegende Wollmilchsau. Do you have something similar in Ireland? It would probably be sheep-based, I guess, not pig-based. No, there's a saying that there's this mystical animal that do everything, yeah, providing pork, giving laying eggs, giving milk, and so on, and wool, and everything. And as we know, it's mystic, so we don't have this all-in-one tool thing that does everything. And the same is true for IFC. It doesn't the answer of everything, but I think it answers some questions very well, for example, how to coordinate design. And as I also see some people that say IFC doesn't work when they do little exercises. And it's not an offense to the single vendor. I could put every other symbol there. But if I just use IFC to export something and re-import into the same tool, that's not the purpose of IFC. It's not a replacement of this own data structure. Yeah, you shouldn't even expect that at work. It's intended to pass information to somebody else to refer to it. It's not meant to be a replacement of your own data structure. And as I said, I could put every other symbol there. And the analogy I'm drawing is with the same argument, you could say that PDF wouldn't work. Because if I'm reading, let's say, Word to PDF and re-import the PDF file in my Word file, what do you get? You probably get the same information as such, the same pieces of words, but probably not the same rendering, the same, let's say, layout on the paper. But still, PDF is a very valuable tool for the industry because it helps you to safely share information. But it's just not meant to be a replacement of Word. And I think many people don't get it. Yeah, it's really, you should think about IFC really as something to share openly information, but not to replace your own tools. So the vision I have is, like, for example, when I was writing a book last year about BIM in Germany, of course I used Word to write this book, but when I had to communicate, for example, with my publisher and editor. Of course, they got a PDF file and they sent me all comments back, and I had to go back into my own authoring tool, being Word, yes, and make the right changes. I did never always accept everything what the editor said, but I reacted on their comments, yes, and then I got a new improved version of my book. Very simple thing, but happens all the time. And the same thing I think is also true with IFC. If I share IFC with somebody else, and he has some complaints, some change requests, for example, on my design, he should not change my design first. I mean, I would not give him access to my own design, as my editor didn't get access on my own Word file. But what I want is, I want their comments, and then I want to have the right to choose how I react on these comments. And that's going the same way. I give the other designers, the client, and so on, an IFC file. It also somehow protects a little bit of my knowledge because it doesn't include all the parametrics there. And then he should comment and give the change request back to me. And this change request back to me would be this BCF file. This other logo stands for this BCF, yeah, the BIM collaboration format, which says, sorry, but you have to change the position of this of the door because, I don't know, the heating wouldn't fit behind. And then it's my decision to do it or make another proposal. This is kind of the same workflow. Yeah, so never think about it would replace its own. It's a workflow for communication of BIM data. Going forward, just after this essential, a little bit on history. As I said, it's a 20 years history, so it's not something that has been invented just recently. I think we are now at this version 4 of IFC. It's also the version that is now European norm or standard. There is some way ahead. I will talk about this later, which is the infrastructure side. But you also see that in the beginning, we had a lot of frequent release changes because it was the time to learn, the time to correct on the schema development and such on the IFC. But now I think the cycle is getting a little bit broader, about 4 to 5 years between major releases, which I think is also the time you need for the industry to respond on it, because there's always a time to implement, to certify, to use, and so on. So I think this 4 to 5 years seems to be a good cycle. It also provides a little bit more stability compared with the yearly release cycles of software itself. So then let's say, could probably expect by the 2018-19, maybe something like IFC 5. When I just go back on this development, I think it's probably more than 15 years now. I probably should update this number. And you just count the time that went into developing the specification. I'm not saying the implementation, the certification, just the specification, just to write the document. I think we probably come to something about 50 person years, just over the time. It's just the amount of effort that went into writing the specification. It also means it's quite unlikely that someone probably will come up with a new one with just 1 person years development. It takes a lot of time to develop it, to get industry consensus, to document it, to get it through all this ISO and whatever release cycles. So it's also quite a hefty, quite a big investment in just in the specification. And then you can multiply this number many times if you count on the time to implement in the various software system, time to use it, and so on. So it's a big thing. When I made this a similar presentation 2 years ago, I really digged in my computer system and tried to find out some of the original figures. And I think my first IFC file I still found were traced back to 1999. So that was the humble beginnings. Nowadays, I think we see that a large construction project managed by that. That was the Open BIM Award winner. So there's also a Building Smart Award like you did today here, the Irish BIM Award. And the winner 2 years ago was the new Osfold Hospital in Norway. It's a big, I think, 500 million hospital project that used IFC for exactly the similar purposes I just mentioned, for coordinating the designs, for doing all the classic issue handling, and so on. So it's an impressive thing. It just opened recently. And they also tried to bring this information further to facility management. You see here a tablet application trying to reuse it then for maintenance purposes. You can go around and see what's behind the ceilings and so on. When I looked this year, just 1 month ago in Jeju, Korea, there was the second award, and I just picked up 2 award winners. One is Seoul Airport, that are using it for one of the new extensions of the airport itself. And here you also see that you often not just use IFC. Here, for example, they use the combination of IFC, PCF, and COBE, just to being interconnected on that. Another award winner was BAM. I also see them here. These are one of the posters outside. But this project is actually in Switzerland, very close to the German border in Basel. There's also a new hospital, Felix Plattner Hospital. And they also got the award because it was here actually used from the beginning, from the architectural competition of it, because the client, as the hospital owner, demanded an architectural competition to have BIM deliverables and to be open to the market of designers. It was based on Open BIM, and from the time of the competition, actually IFC was the delivery format up till facility management now. So what I just wanted to say, it's now in real use. In the next series, I just want to briefly take you through one of the very typical workflow that's supported, and we call it the reference workflow. I think with reference, we mean really if you go back into the earlier times when you had XRef files, when you did some design a few years ago. What was the idea of XRef or whatever it was called in the different software packages? Was normally similar things that I linked somebody else's drawings into my environment, so I could access it, I could measure it, I could get the information, but it never included it directly in my design. It also has a responsibility and liability issues behind, yeah? Who is allowed to change? Also, there are also some legal implications about. And very similar, I think we also have what I would call a BIM reference workflow. It's to refer or to reference other information, comment on it, but do not change it. And very similar, I think, I just wanted to show you in a very simple example how this would work. I think we all, and I think probably also when I'm listening here, think about the idea of federated models. Yeah, it's also I think the UK BIM strategy talks about federated models and so on. So we have our own partial discipline models that will be federated in a common coordination model. That works very perfectly with IFC. You have the different disciplines and you federate your model. This can then, of course, be visualized in some viewing technology. It could be online, could be cloud-based, it could be just visual coordination, it could include class detection or rule checking like Solibri and those tools. But essentially you work on then on this federated model. And here issues are normally identified. Could be clashes, could be new client demands saying please change this and that. Here this example was that the client demands, for example, to enlarge the bathroom here. So that means moving this this wall. And of course, this might have effect to many of the disciplines. The architect has to probably make a new interior design, but the HVAC designer probably has to move the HVAC equipment and the piping and so on. So if in this federated model, this change request is decided, like we see it here, then you would issue a BCF message saying there is a change request, and this is now addressed, let's say, to the architect and the HVAC engineer. Well, both designs are affected by this change request. Then you would send the BCF file to the related designer, not the IFC. The IFC is a one way and stays in the federated environment. So we would send the BCF file, and nowadays you can send it by email, you can put up a web service for that, like BIMCollab and others. So that is up to you to choose. But essentially, you're distributing the message of the change request. And then when the message of the change request goes to the architect, in his BIM authoring environment, he could read the message. He would know, because it also stores, of course, the IDs of the elements. He could automatically be highlighted and zoomed into that area of change. Then here, the architect would read the message and would actually then execute the change. In that case, he would remove this bath tube and then move the wall and reorganize, let's say, the bathroom. And then what he would do now, he would then repeat on the change request, which is an answer to the BCF message, saying I have actually done the change, or maybe I could not do the change because of whatever reason. And he would then send his updated IFC model back to the federated model and make an update there. So here you would now see the new design on this right-hand side with the enlarged bathroom. And then, of course, you would also expect the feedback from the HVAC designer. Is it possible to, I don't know, move all the pipes and so on? And then you can either close the issue or you have to do more. And this is a kind of workflow very common to the building industry that's very well supported. And again, it's using many several standards, IFC, BCF, and maybe even this new web services. So I think that's something which is ready to use today, and you saw it also with the awards that it is used and it's reality. But now let's look a little bit in the future. And as I said, one of the future topics is infrastructure. Since about maybe 5 years, this topic came up more and more. And really, when you look back, oh, by the way, I'm an architect of training, so I'm also coming from the building side. But when you look back, I'm really astonished that infrastructure comes too late, because these are huge investments. They are very often public investments, public client investments. They are quite often not as complex, but huge. Yeah. If you count the number of elements at a bridge, it's probably not the same as in a hospital, but it's huge. But fundamental problems are similar. You have to coordinate it, you have to integrate data, you have to use GIS information and so on. And you can gain a lot from this 3D BIM approach, from public involvement and so on. So really it took a while to realize it, I think across the industry or also across the clients. But now there is a big demand on infrastructure. Coming from Germany, we now have a government mandate in Germany, which is probably not so much known, to build all new federal infrastructure projects in BIM in 2020. So it's a government mandate, very similar to the UK mandate, but it's specific for infrastructure, and it calls for bridges, roads, railways, and waterways. But when you look in industry, and both from tools, from regulations, from standards, and so on, there's not so much in infrastructure. So we have to keep up. And since the last 2 or 3 years, the main focus on IFC, further development really is on infrastructure. Of course, you can use today IFC already to exchange the geometry of infrastructure projects. That's, for example, in Civil 3D exported as IFC, what you see there. So you get the geometry, you get the attributes and so on, but you do not really have the specific classes and, let's say, spatial arrangements, what you normally have. Or the UK, COBI for infrastructure, I think they are using the building stories as being the equivalent for sections along a road. You have difficulties adapting from one to the other. So what we really have to do is we have to work, we should write a new version of IFC that is dedicated to infrastructure. That's now in scope, it's called IFC 5. And it will deal at the beginning with this four issues. On the central part, we have the alignment, which is true for all infrastructure projects, very, very, very important. And also alignment together with the digital terrain model. That means getting access to GIS information. And then there are roads, bridges, railways, and tunnels. Bridges now is an active project that started this year to be finished in 2 years, as being to have an IFC bridge final release. Road and railways, we see big initiatives in Asia, and I will come back to that. So for the alignment, by the end of the year, there will be a version IFC 4.1 that includes alignment data, which is the alignment itself, and it's data related to the alignment, like positioning, to position something on kilometer 55 along the alignment. It's the cross sections, the line strings, which is the kind of operation maintenance approach to it when you look from above. And it also includes more advanced 3D geometry, particularly for sweeping cross sections along this alignment. IFC Road, there's a huge government project in Korea that's recently finished. They presented it also, or handed over the results to Building Smart to be taken up for an international standard, which is about road construction. I think this project itself was of, $5 million just to develop the specification. And it's about developing road models, mainly for the handover of the design to the contractor and to the regulatory bodies to approve and finalize the design. We see something similar in China. China Railways has created the so-called China Railways BIM Alliance, and that's the world's biggest railway organization. And they decided to build their own China BIM standards based on IFC and presented a railway pre-standard, so-called IFC rail, including all the specifics, the rail tracks, the substructure, the stations, the tunnels and bridges along, including even in the new version, the signals, which is quite interesting to have also the rail infrastructure. So also huge in development. Oh, I see the red light, I have to finish. Probably 2 or 3 more slides. One of the big chances is to integrate this now, because all three are slightly different. So there has to be a so-called common project to integrate this, which is shown on this slide, which is the new kind of schedule towards 2018, to integrate this railroad and bridge in this common definition to make it harmonized, and then build the various extensions. For that, we definitely have to work together with other industries and also other bodies. For example, when you talk about infrastructure, you definitely have to talk about GIS standards, like developed from OGC, because infrastructure relates a lot to GIS. And this is actually happening. Right now, in parallel to today, there's in London a common conference between Building Smart and OGC, particularly on this topic, how to use GIS information. So that will be the next big development step, and hopefully finished by 2018. And with this picture, just to see that also IFC, as every other product, has its own life cycle, I would like to finish my presentation. I hope I could give you a good overview on it and provided this kind of perspective. And thank you for inviting me, and wish you a very successful award later today.